Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
It's a pleasure for me to welcome back Ramesh Raskar to MSR. He was an intern here back in 98 with Michael Cohen and Rick Zaleski. Ramesh got his PhD in computer science at UNC Chapel Hill back in 2000, and he's currently senior research scientist at Merle. Ramesh has done a lot of very interesting stuff, you know, ranging from computational photography to non-photorealistic rendering, to camera projector systems, and he's going to be talking about some of the other exciting work that he's been doing recently. Ramesh.
Good. Thanks, Ingbing. Great pleasure to be here. And today I'll be talking about coded imaging. Let's imagine this taxi that's zipping through Kendall Square right outside my office in Cambridge. The problem is when there is low light conditions, we are forced to take pictures with sufficient exposure duration. But we would like to capture this image as if the picture was taken with very short exposure duration and it's nice and bright. So can we just take an approximate crop of this taxi where we can barely see any of the text, the name of the company or the taxi number, and in software be able to deblur so that we can see the features very clearly in this case. It seems like a challenging problem because if you start with a very short exposure image as shown on the left, you get a very dark picture. If you start with a picture that has a sufficiently long exposure duration where the shutter is open for let's say about 100 milliseconds, you get a photo that has all the high spatial frequencies missing. And so if you try to deblur that as shown here on the bottom right, you end up getting banding artifacts and many high spatial frequencies are completely lost. So you get this very noisy image. So what's going on here? If you think about it, motion blur is simply a convolution with a box function. So each point on this toy train here, in this specific case, has been blurred horizontally by this box function. And box in time is a sink in the frequency domain, and a convolution with box in time domain is multiplication of with sync in the frequency domain. And as soon as we look at this figure, we realize that the blurred image will have high spatial frequencies highly attenuated, and in addition, many other lower frequencies will also be attenuated to zero. And so when you take a picture with a traditional camera, the damage is done. The high spatial frequencies are lost. And no matter what you do, you will not be able to recover them. All you can do is hallucinate and try to create a picture that looks like it has some of the higher spatial frequencies. So what's the solution to overcome this loss of high spatial frequencies? Maybe we can design a camera so that instead of keeping the shutter open for the entire duration, we can open and close the shutter in a carefully chosen binary sequence. And of course, it's difficult to create a shutter, mechanical shutter that will rapidly change its shape. So what we did was we used a ferroelectric LCD and changed its opacity. It became transparent or opaque in a carefully chosen binary sequence so that we can stop or start the integration of light. But at the end, you still have just one photo. This is just a traditional Canon Pro S1 with some minor circuitry to trigger this ferroelectric shutter.
Sort of a minor, when it's transparent, how transparent is it? How much light actually gets through?
When it's transparent, this particular one is based on two polarization filters. So when it's transparent, it's about 25% 25% transparent. And when it's opaque, the contrast ratio is 1,000 as to 1.
Right, so when it's transparent, it's still blocking.
It is right now, in this particular implementation. But you can do this stopping and starting of integration in many other ways. This is just the simplest way you can do outside. For example, if you're using a point gray camera, you can do this in firmware with just one line of change in code. You can just give an external signal to a point gray camera, to the CCD, and you can drive it with any particular gating sequence. So you can do it with at no cost as well. But we wanted to do it on a nice high resolution professional quality digital camera. Okay, so what do we do, what happens when we open and close the shutter in this binary sequence? Well, we're going to get a convolution of the sharp image with this chosen binary sequence. And as long as we chose this binary sequence for which the frequency transform is broadband, that means it has energy at all the frequencies, we can be sure that the effective MTF, effective modulation transfer function of this process is also broadband. That means all the high spatial frequencies are preserved. They may be attenuated, but there is some hope to recover them. So if you go back to the deblurring process, which is simply inverting the frequency transform of the blurring process, then you'll see that in a traditional camera, you get this banding artifacts and ringing artifacts. But in case of this flutter shutter camera, which uses coding for the exposure, we can recover an image that looks as good as the static image. Yes?
So what if you deferred the integration to software? What if you captured lots of images at short exposure?
Right.
It'd be noisy, but could you defer the integration to software? And then it seems like there'd be other advantages.
So you're basically asking for a high-speed camera.
Right.
There are a couple of problems with high-speed camera. First of all, the bandwidth is going to be a challenging problem. And the second is that, as you know very well, in underexposed region, the noise dominates the signal. So all you have is a sequence of images with just noise dominating the signal. And statistically, you're not going to get any better result. The flash paper that you guys worked on here, has a very nice analysis of noise. We know that the longer the exposure, the more number of photons you're counting on the sensor, the better you are with the sensor. So here, this is really a trade-off between sharpness of the image and the noise. And here's another example of just something taken on Broadway Street, just outside our office, where if you zoom in on this car, it's difficult to make out the make of the car or the license plate number. It looks like maybe it's an Audi, but when you deblur, you realize it's a Volkswagen with this particular license plate.
Okay.
Yes?
The deblurring, the box filter depends on the speed and direction of the objects are moving.
But yes.
Do you need to know that, or can you infer that?
So in this particular case, we are saying the user has to draw a line to indicate the direction of motion at the magnitude of motion. But you're right. You can use other methods to possibly recover those point spread function. And the paper that Rob Fergus and Bill Freeman worked on last year showed a pretty interesting approach. I mean, it's a blind deconvolution problem of how do you estimate the blur as well as the quantities. And what we're saying is you can continue to use those approaches to estimate the point spread function, but you should use an image in which the damage is not done yet. You have preserved the high spatial frequencies. And you can continue to use the other approaches for your deblurring process. And in fact, because we have preserved all the high spatial frequencies, the problem becomes so much easier that I can just solve AX equals B and X equals A / B. I don't have to do any post-processing. So all the results I'm showing you here are simply solving a linear system. It's not using Richardson-Lucy iterative traditional solutions for deblurring. So it's as simple as that.
So it's the noise that we observe here. Mm-hmm. Mostly sensor noise or deconvolution?
It's deconvolution noise. Almost all of it. Because if you look at the input image, it's not as noisy. So almost all of it is deconvolution noise.
Slightly different from standard deconvolution in that there is occlusion changes in objects.
Yeah, so there are a lot of limitations, right? Because all we're saying is if we can get a nice clear signal over that duration with no interference with other signals, then I can do this deconvolution in a reasonable way. If it interferes with background, if it gets occluded during that time, and so on, then I have issues. So all those issues, we discuss it in the paper, how you may be able to do that using other image analysis computer vision techniques. But this is just the basic concept. And, despite those limitations, there are certain cases where this works ideally. you know, imagine you are capturing some data sets for, I don't know, maybe for virtual Earth with Wexel cameras, which are huge aperture cameras because they want to take a picture with very short exposure, right? If you take a picture with a traditional camera during this duration of, say, 100 milliseconds, you'll get a blur in aerial imaging. If you take it with short exposure, you might get noisy. But with this solution, you can use just an average digital camera and recover these images. This is a simulation, by the way. And to overcome this problem, a traditional aerial imaging company will use a very expensive camera for which the aperture is extremely large, but then correspondingly depth of field is very narrow, and you have to fly a special aircraft just to take those pictures. But maybe we can do this now with very simple cameras, because the motion is very simple. It's just a 1D simple motion and no issues of occlusions, unless you're flying very low in a, on top of high-rise buildings. Okay, so that was a solution for motion deblurring, or trying to preserve information in presence of motion. What about trying to preserve or try to deblur images that are blurred because of being out of focus? And it's a very straightforward extension of our paper from our idea from last year. So you can take a photo where the frame is in sharp focus, it's misfocused, and the woman is out of focus. We can do a very similar trick and deblur to this particular image, where now you can even capture the glint in the eye and recover a sharply focused image. And the idea, as I said, is a simple extension of the idea from last year. In case of motion deblurring, we used a 1D broadband code to flutter the shutter open and closed, so that in case of motion, the blur has can be reversed. In case of defocus blur, instead of using a 1D code, we're going to use a 2D code, which is also broadband, which means it's frequency transform. A 2D frequency transform of this crossword puzzle-shaped mask has energy at all the frequencies in 2D. And in this case, we are just using a 7x7 mask. So those 49 elements in the frequency transform will have non-zero values. And when you put this mask in this particular aperture, then you are able to, again, preserve all the high spatial frequencies. So the implementation is very straightforward. This is a Canon EF lens, and we just cut open the aperture, and you take this crossword puzzle mask, and you simply insert that here, and just take a picture through this, and you're done. So as far as the consumer is concerned, the photograph, at least the parts that are in sharp focus, looks like any average photograph. But the parts that are blurred have all the useful high spatial frequencies preserved in an encoded form, which we must decode in post-processing stage.
But you still have noise when you do that, right? You have deconvolution noise.
You will still have deconvolution noise, that's right. But for a consumer, this photo is good enough if they didn't want to do anything more. But after deconvolving it, they'll get an image that looks like this.
And you avoid ringing.
And you can avoid ringing as well, exactly. Yes?
Aren't you compromising by limiting the number of photons that hit the total number of sensors?
That's a very good point. So you're giving up about 50% of the light, right? And this seems somewhat odd. You're going down by an f-stop. But the point really here is that if you're taking a picture and just stopping there, then yes, the picture is about half as bright. But usually in deep blurring, what you really care about is the deconvolution noise. And what we can prove is that our deconvolution noise is better by a factor of about 70 dB with respect to a solution you would get if you just had a short exposure image, or in this case, a narrow aperture image. So you win in a very big way with respect to the deconvolution noise. So the combination of half the number of photons, but a win by a factor of 20 in deconvolution noise still allows you to win by a factor of 10 here. And of course, you have to choose the right parameters. I'm choosing a 7x7 code, but there are many ways to optimize that particular code. Yes?
What's the ratio of light you get if you wanted to have this in focus with a small aperture? Because if you reduce the aperture, right, this entire scene will be in focus.
Exactly.
What is the ratio of that amount of light to the amount of light that you never experienced?
So the best way to compare that would be to have only, out of the 7x7 aperture, have only one cell open. So it'll be 1x49 brightness compared to the picture I showed earlier. Yes?
Are these binary masks open properly and spatially, are they better than continuous masks?
That's a very excellent question. It was always bugging me. In fact, the reason I chose binary codes in the beginning is because searching the code is not an easy task. Because you want to find a code for which the frequency transform is flat, which means, and if you have, in this particular case, we had a code that's about 52 values long. So the space is 2 to the 52. And you simply cannot search through that space efficiently to compute that. So if you make it a continuous code, it's even more challenging to do that. So binary space is easier to search. But then now we have come up with more a better search algorithm, a gradient descent algorithm that gives us. The first time I ran the code, I let it run in MATLAB for about 3 days, and I still didn't get anything back. And it was a randomized search. I still didn't get code that's reasonably good. So the distribution of the codes is very, very sparse. There is no, so far I haven't found an analytical form, so if anybody has ideas of how to compute analytically a broadband code for this particular application, which is linear convolution. There are broadband codes that are used in communication and audio and astronomy, but those are circular convolution. For that, there is analytical form.
Isn't the limit case with temporal fluttering that if you have white noise in, then the spectrum is flat?
If you have white noise, then you're getting better and better. But creating a white noise for a 52-valued signal is not that easy. So it's basically a pseudo-random code.
Yeah.
Pseudo-random code, turns out, is not good enough.
I see.
And in the paper, we show comparisons of several pseudo-random codes. Okay. And as I said, the distribution is really, really sparse.
Yeah. So I guess if an object is out of focus and moving, then you want to combine it together.
That should be the next paper. It's probably possible to combine both in the same picture, but we are not working on that. Yes.
So is there some sense in which binary filters are better than continuous ones?
Oh yeah, I should have. I didn't finish answering your question. So the question was, are continuous codes better than binary codes? And yes, they are. The continuous codes. I mean, just. It's intuitive because you have more freedom in choosing the code. So the frequency transform of continuous codes, at least, as I said, there's no analytical formula I have come up with so far. And it appears that the continuous codes are easier to find and have the converge faster to a better solution. So yeah, there is hope. But again, as far as the device design is concerned, you just find this code once and you just put it in, and then you can use it all the time. Yes?
You've shown the Steve-Hurin case for linear motion,
right,
and radially symmetric.
Right.
What about most of the blurring, which is camera shake, which is not linear?
Yes. And what I should clarify is that this technique of either flutter shutter or coded aperture is for preserving the high spatial frequencies. There's another problem, which is estimating what the point spread function is. For example, like Daniel asked, how fast is the taxi moving? Or in your case, how was the camera shaking? That has to be estimated from some other method. And what I can claim, but I haven't proved, is it might be easier to estimate the camera shape from a single image if we are using a flutter shutter. And as I said, last year there was a nice paper on blind deconvolution to estimate the camera shape.
Use a known point source in the image, or a postulated point source in the image, or
Output gyros.
Exactly.
Yeah, so I think the camera shake
gyros
problem.
Gyros are only good for about 2 f-stops. It looks like yours are good for much more than 2 f-stops.
Exactly. So I feel like the camera shake problem is solved as far as hardware is concerned. And anything we can do in software is simply going to help it. But what we are doing here is we're actually preserving the high spatial frequencies. So a gyro-based solution, in addition to flutter shutter, which should take care of most of camera shake problems.
Well, I meant gyro is giving you the information of the actual
exactly.
camera movement.
Exactly. Yes?
Do you think that the SLR is the best application scenario, or do you think it would be useful for like point and shoots with a fixed, you know, the camera at like $3 with a fixed focal range? Do you think your method could be useful for these scenarios?
Absolutely, absolutely, yeah. In fact, what's interesting is that one of the most interesting applications for this is macro photography, where if your flower or your bug is within the focusing range of your camera, so you can never focus it, right. You can take a picture with this and bring it in sharp focus. And I don't have results on the slides, but that seems like an application that has no other solution. All right? And just to clarify what's going on, so if I take a picture of a point light source, and this is how we calculate the point spread function, in fact, and take a picture with a disk-shaped aperture, then the point spread function is also disk-shaped, and it loses all the high spatial frequencies, and the corresponding deblurring is unstable. On the other hand, if you use that 7x7 crossword puzzle aperture, then the blur is encoded, and so it becomes reversible, and so the corresponding deblurring process also is well conditioned. And to compare with a traditional camera, if you look at the photo with the traditional camera versus a coded aperture camera, the photo looks very similar. But when you deblur it, you will see ringing artifacts in a traditional camera, but hardly any ringing artifacts with a coded aperture camera. Okay? So it seems magical, and like Mike said, you know, we are reducing the number of photons, but by blocking light, somehow we seem to be preserving more information. And this is an interesting notion. And why put the mask just here? Why not put masks somewhere else? And so my talk today is really about this less is more, the notion of coding. It appears that by blocking light in time, we can support motion deblurring. By blocking light in space, in aperture, we can support focus deblurring. And for the remaining of the presentation, I'm going to focus on two of the other types of coded methods. One is called optical heterodyning, which will allow you to capture a light field. And last method will be coded illumination, where we are blocking outgoing light and supporting motion capture and depth edge detection. Okay? And I feel that the field of computational photography is going through three phases. The first phase we have seen, I like to call it epsilon photography, where the goal has been to create an ultimate camera that mimics the human eye. It has ultimate dynamic range, it has wide field of view, and so on. And typically we are going to take multiple photos by perturbing the camera parameters. And I use the term epsilon photography, borrowing it from epsilon geometry, where the concept is you want to create a robust estimate by perturbing your parameters. And that's exactly what we're doing. We're trying to create a robust estimate of the scene by perturbing the parameters. And this is what today's photo editors and consumer softwares are supporting. High dynamic range, auto-stitching, panoramas, high depth of field by taking multiple photos. And you know, something I have played with in this field as well, by taking, say, a non-flash and a flash image. Here you see your own reflection if you are taking a picture of a painting with a glass frame. If you take a picture with flash, you don't see a reflection, but you see a hot spot. And then by combining the two, you can get a picture that has none of these artifacts. It's kind of a better camera. But we used a method called gradient vector projection, which gives us this particular result. But the interesting part is that by looking at the residual of gradient vector projection, we can also recover the reflection layer. And this we presented at SIGGRAPH 2005. So this is kind of an example of epsilon photography, changing illumination parameters in this particular case. But the second phase that we're entering in computational photography is coded photography, where the goal is to take a single photo, or in some cases just a few photos that encode the information about the scene by trading off some other parameters, usually the resolution. And instead of thinking about a pixel as sampling a particular patch in the scene at a given instant, at a given under a given illumination, we're going to let that pixel be a linear or nonlinear combination of radiance from multiple patches in the scene. Okay, so it's going to be a reversible encoding of the information in the scene. And for that, we might use additional sensors. We might use funky optics. We might change illumination and put light sources in strategic positions, and so on. And this is getting closer and closer to understanding more about the scene, maybe doing a separation of global and direct components of the radiance, or maybe doing a diffuse and specular decomposition of the scene, and so on. And this is where we're going to see more and more action, because we would like to capture everything in a single snapshot, or very few snapshots. And the third phase, I think that's going to be very exciting, is breaking this notion that photograph has to represent what's typically seen by a human eye, which is it's taken at a single instant, from a single viewpoint under a single lighting condition. And this is what I think is really going to create new art forms in photography. I don't think we have really enabled new art forms with the kind of computational photography research we have seen so far. But I think by breaking these constraints and barriers, some of them conceptual, we might be able to create new art forms with computational photography. So let's focus back on the second element, which is coded photography. And by the way, what's interesting for us as researchers is not just thinking about or predicting what kind of cameras you will see in 5 years or 10 years from now, but also thinking about what kind of software might be required to support such cameras. It's not going to be a software that just processes images as if they're taken by a camera that mimics a human eye. These are going to be images that are, for example, human eye doesn't do deconvolution. We don't have deconvolution. We can do any kind of filtering, but we don't do deconvolution. So we need to start supporting software that does, and deconvolution is just a very simple example. But we need to think about software that supports such futuristic cameras. Question back there?
I was just thinking about the Jinx. Well, I don't know if this goes in the third category. You can also use your previous method to add blur, right?
Yes.
So if you had a camera, I'm still thinking about the low-cost scenario. So if you had a camera with a very, very small lens, because it's like a camera for $5.
Right.
Could I use your technique to generate photographs and have a good separation of foreground and background to do like portrait photography? Would normally take me like an expensive camera with a big lens. Could you now produce a similar effect with a small lens?
I think it's possible, but I'm not going to claim it will work with my method. Because you can actually look at the Fisher information and say that if any image that is using a coded aperture, it can either record intensities or it can record depth-dependent information. It cannot do both. So if I'm going to use coded aperture, I can guarantee you that it's not going to be good for estimating depth. And but on the other hand, if you have an image that is optimized for capturing depth, it will not be optimized for capturing the image intensities. So you have to give up something. And especially if you have a cheap camera with a relatively narrow aperture, then it's going to be very difficult to estimate depth. But once you estimate depth using some other method, maybe, I don't know, ranging, some other ranging method, then yes, what you're saying makes a lot of sense, creating an illusion that the camera actually has a very narrow depth of field and what's out of interest can be blurred out of focus. But that can be done by some other image analysis method as well. Maybe you can train based on other images of limited depth of field and say this usually is important, this is usually not so important. So you might be able to estimate what's important using other methods as well, using some image statistics. Okay? So let's go back to the coded photography and think about what we can do with this very simple method of using a mask, something you can just do at home. Or if it's a cell phone camera, you can just print a transparency and hold it in front of the lens and create this kind of effects. Unfortunately, although you can put a mask right in front of the lens, you can't really put mask inside the lens yet. So, but I'm going to describe a method anyway, which might stimulate some more thinking. So what happens if you put a mask very close to the sensor? And I'm going to describe that. By putting a mask close to the sensor, you can capture the light field that's entering or passing through this lens. What are some other methods to capture light field? And in fact, before I go there, what's a light field anyway? In a traditional camera, when a point is in sharp focus, all the rays that are starting from that point and passing through the lens are focused at a single pixel. And although this point is in sharp focus, any variation of energy along this incident rays is completely lost. So you can think of this image as a projection of a higher dimensional representation. What we would like to achieve in light fields is not just get the intensities for every point, but also get intensities for each of the incident rays. And light field, Lumi graph, various names being used for it. And if you talk to people in physics, they get really offended if you use the word light field, because it's not really an electromagnetic field. Okay. So one method to deal with capturing light field, and this is a slide I stole from Renning's presentation, and this is their approach, in fact, is to displace the sensor away from its ideal position and put a microlens array so that on this sensor you'll capture the variation along each of these incident rays. And the way they achieved that was by using a microlens array, and in this particular case, every lens, microlens, has about 14 by 14 pixels under that lens. So you get a very low resolution image, a 292 by 292 pixel image, by starting with a 16 megapixel sensor. Very low resolution image, but you get a very powerful ability to digitally refocus the captured picture. So you can, after the photo has been captured, you can do digital refocusing. And the question is, can we do this simply by using a mask with no lenslet array, no complicated calibration procedure, no issues of chromatic aberration, no issues of missing pixels at the boundary between the micro lenses. So that's kind of a surprising result for us. And since we don't have an access to the sensor in a traditional camera, we just built our own camera by using a flatbed scanner, just a $70 Canon flatbed scanner. And we slapped in front of this very old view camera I bought on eBay. And now we have this 200 megapixel imager. And we put a mask simply in front of this glass of the flatbed scanner. So it's not very precise at all. It's about 1 centimeter in front of the flatbed scanner. Okay, and I'll show you what we can do with it. So when you capture this image, and I'll describe what kind of mask we're going to use as well, it encodes the light field. If I zoom in on this particular square, you'll see that it's already recording a lot of the variation of those incident rays. But unlike light field images you may have seen in the past, even the interior between those circles is a low frequency representation of that scene. So if I go back, there's a low frequency representation of the out of focus part. So if you squint your eye, you can actually see the structure here as well. Right? And now from that, we can do digital refocusing. So right now it's focused on the cones in the back. But this movie is going to show you how we can digitally refocus on the cones in the middle and then all the way to this birthday cones, just hats, birthday hats in the front. So the output here is only about 200 by 200 pixels. You start with a 200 megapixel image and you get a 200 by 200 image. It's kind of similar to the Stanford solution. We start with a 16 megapixel sensor. But the point is that we can capture a light field using just a mask. And we can also recompute the neighboring views by taking 2D slices of the 4D light field. And this is just a standard method. There's nothing new we are doing here. This is simply simulating the views as they would have been taken with a pinhole that was being displaced within the aperture of the camera. Okay. So what's going on here? We are trying to capture a 4D incident signal on a 2D sensor without using any refractive element like a microlens array. And how is that possible? The analogy I like to give is listening to radio stations on your car radio. There are hundreds of radio stations transmitting their signal, an audio signal, let's say about 10 kilohertz bandwidth. And it's just a 1D signal. And your radio also receives a 1D signal, which is some linear combination of all those signals. But magically, you're able to tune into any one of them and listen to any specific radio audio signal. And the reason why that's possible is because each of the radio station is transmitting at a different frequency. And they are doing that by heterodyning their audio signal with a particular carrier, say 99 megahertz or 100 megahertz or 101 megahertz. So maybe we can do something similar when we're capturing a high-dimensional signal on a lower-dimensional sensor. And the analogy you can draw here is that the light field that's entering the scene is a lower-dimensional signal, band-limited. But we're going to capture that with an extremely high-resolution sensor. Right? In Stanford's case, it's about a 300 by 300 image, 14 by 14 views. But they're going to capture it on a 16-megapixel sensor, a very high-resolution sensor. But in our case, before the light field is projected onto a 2D sensor, a 4D light field on a 2D sensor, we're going to modulate that with a carrier. And the carrier is going to be our high-frequency mask, which is very close to the sensor. So what we have on the sensor is a modulated signal. That's what goes out. That's what gets received on your car's radio. And then in software, we're going to use a base, which is the reference carrier, and going to demodulate each of the input frequency channels corresponding to the spatial and angular variations in the light field. Okay? So let me explain this concept a little bit more, but this is the key concept, capturing a 4D signal with a 2D sensor. I'm showing a specific application for a camera, but it can be used in any other field as well.
The kind of naive approach in my mind is just putting a sort of a pinhole.
That's right.
A grid of pinholes at the sensor location from the sensor back, which is essentially the same as what Stanford guys did, except it's a
exactly.
grid of pinholes.
Exactly.
Is this the same as
that? It's quite different, and I'll explain how. I'll give you an analogy of how that particular case would work. But that's a good way to think about it, by the way. So very briefly, you can think of your sensor as a high bandwidth slice in the frequency domain of the light field, and you have a band-limited light field that you would like to capture. But clearly, the extra sensor bandwidth is not enough to capture the extra dimension, which is the angular variation in your light field. And so you would like to somehow transform this energy to the sensor slice. So the solution is to use the modulation theorem via heterodyning. And we're going to put a mask that's going to perform a frequency domain convolution so that we're going to create replicas of this particular light field. And it's going to be convolved in this particular way. And it turns out the ideal function for this is a function for which the frequency transform is a series of the spikes. And if you look at this, you realize that these are just sum of cosines. And if you take sum of four cosines, you'll get this particular waveform, which is because there's no negative light. So our mask is going to be in form of this kind of tiles. That's it. So we're going to put this, so each of the tile might be really small here. And we're going to create a mask, which is just printed on an A4 size paper, because that's what the size of a flatbed scanner is. And we put it on top of the scanner, and now we're ready to use our light field camera. And by using this mask, we're going to convolve and create a modulated light field. And then the sensor is going to get a horizontal slice of it. So if you take a closer look at this image, so in this particular image, although we started with a 200 megapixel sensor image, we subsample it down to 1629 by 2052 pixel image, because the sensor on a flatbed scanner is really low quality. So we just smooth it out and subsample. But if you take its 2D frequency transform, so ignore everything about the flatbed scanner and its hardware complications. Imagine you have a sensor with this resolution. In case of Stanford system, it's 4,000 by 4,000. In our case, it's 1629 by 2052. If you take this image and take its 2D frequency transform, that's it. You get this beautiful structure where you get 9 by 9 tiles corresponding to 9 by 9 angular variations that we were expecting to see. And if you take its, if you retile each, if you reshape these 2D tiles into a 4D volume, then you have created the frequency transform of the light field. And if you take its 4D inverse frequency transform, then you get back the incident 4D light field. And you can use it to take projections or slices to refocus the images or see neighboring views. So these are the two designs. The first design, both of them use masks to encode the incoming light field. If I put the mask in the aperture, I get an encoded blur camera where we can capture the blur in a reversible way. And it allows us to do full resolution digital refocusing. So if your camera is 4 megapixel, your output will also be 4 megapixel. You're not losing any resolution. But it can only deal with moderately complex scenes, usually layered, few layers of scenes. And in this particular case, we will end up using a broadband mask in the aperture, which has energy at all the frequencies. And by putting a mask in the optical path, we're performing a convolution of the image with the mask. On the other hand, if you put the mask near the sensor, we create this heterodyned light field camera, which can perform very complex digital refocusing, but at a correspondingly reduced resolution. And in this case, the mask is not broadband, but it's narrowband, specifically sum of 4 cosines in the example I showed. And in this case, the light field is being convolved in the frequency domain. It's being multiplied in the primal domain, but convolved in the frequency domain. And so now I think we can really figure out what's going on when we start putting occluders in a path of a light field. And as I said, I'm showing an application specifically for what's happening inside the camera, but you can think of these occluders, which are just 2D manifolds, in path of any 4D light field. And it gives you a mechanism to compute what the light field will be after it has passed through a given occluder. Yes?
So the object is in focus, that both of these designs, you won't lose any spatial resolution.
Exactly.
Some intensity resolution.
It will be about half as bright. That's a very important point, yeah. For a consumer, if everything is sharp focus, the image will look identical.
It's your advantage over the lens-led approach, where there you always lose.
Exactly. So this particular image is really 1629 by 2052. So the consumer already has the final photo. And we show in the paper how you can also get rid of any minor artifacts you may have because of the cosine mask. Because we know what the attenuating function is. It's not uniform. It's not 50% dark uniform. It has this particular pattern. But we know that a priori. So we can just normalize the captured image with this particular attenuating factor. And so we get a full resolution image, and it's transparent to the user. And that's the big advantage over light field cameras that use any refractive element.
Have you tried building a prototype, or you actually get the mask in front of the CCD sensor?
The problem with putting a mask in front of an actual camera is that there are a lot of other things in front of a traditional camera. For example, there is a UV IR filter and so on. And so we opened some, we damaged about 3 cameras already. I think we'll get it right in the next few months. The other solution is to just buy a very expensive camera, you know, just a medium format camera with a digital back. That's what the Stanford folks did. But then you have to worry about having a very micrometer precise alignment and so on, because they have 2 very strong constraints in the design. The first constraint is that the lens has to focus the image on the micro lens, and the second constraint is that the micro lens has to focus the main lens onto the sensor, and they have to satisfy both constraints to get something reasonable. In our case, there are no constraints. You can put the mask roughly where you want. In our case, it's just about 1 centimeter, and if you do place it somewhere else, the only disadvantage or only loss would be that you may not get all the angular variation because it's not at the optimal location, but it'll still work. So that's the benefit. So in the future, you can imagine your aperture dial has many functions. You know, you can change your aperture settings by stops, But maybe there is a last dial which says this code at the aperture, that code at the sensor, and so on. And so the same camera may be able to support different types of operations as well. So for example, digital refocused images or light field capture and so on, simply by changing the mask. Yes?
Question. So I'm still not really clear about how the coded aperture is aligned to the sensor, mm-hmm. especially if you could compare it to, Shmi and I a couple of years ago had a sensor in which every certain pattern of dim sensors, I don't know what he did.
The lensless imaging. Are you talking about the lensless imaging?
No, this was in order to capture high dynamic range scenes.
Okay, so he has a locally varying attenuation factor on the LCD capture the high dynamic range.
How is this different, sort of his locally attenuated mask and this aperture? Because, I mean, in his case, the frequency is at sensor resolution, which is as high as you can go.
Right.
And here, your aperture seems to have some frequency that seems to be lower than the sensor frequency, but at what rate? And the attenuation might be another interesting way to capture half of the data still.
Exactly. That's a great connection you made, actually. I haven't thought about that. Just to repeat the question, so what's the relationship between other types of LCDs or masks people have used closer to the sensor? And if you think about the bare mosaic, it's also a type of a mask. Yeah. And so you can imagine folding in your wavelength and dynamic range ability, light field ability, all those functions in a single mask, as opposed to having masks for different operations. And if you can have a programmable mask by putting an LCD, maybe you can perform very sophisticated operations as well. Maybe at one photo you get a monochrome image at very higher light field resolution, but at the very next instant you get an RGB image with digital refocusing ability and so on. So you can play with those three parameters, or maybe even more, by using such masks. And that's the advantage of masks. They're so simple. And you already have masks that are at the resolution of a pixel, which are bare mosaics. Yes?
Go back to Michael's question about how does it relate to an array of pixels.
Okay, yes. So if you go back to this particular image, you can think of array of pinholes, which is just an impulse train. And it's going to be the frequency transform of an impulse train is an impulse train, which means you'll end up creating infinite number of replicas of your light field, right? Which means most of the energy will be lost. What happens here is you're getting just enough replicas so that your sensor can sample your whole light field, right? You have transferred the energy in such a way that your sensor can transfer. So that's why it's most efficient. Imagine if these impulse trains went all over. First of all, you're losing energy because you're making too many replicas. Even in the primal domain, your duty cycle is going to be really low because it's going to block most of the light. And number three, which is very important, and the point that Hughes brought up, is that you'll only get a light field. You will not get the original full resolution image when it was in sharp focus. Here, you still get the full resolution image. On top of that, you can slice the data in a different way to get the light field. So there are various benefits. But that's the right way to think about it. What would you do? What happens when you put an array of pinholes in an optical path? And this is exactly what happens. By the way, of course, I'm showing all these diagrams in the flat land. So it's just a 1D sensor and 2D light field. But the concepts, of course, apply to 4D light fields and 2D sensors. Yes?
In the 2D mask, you're assuming there are no geometric problems with the lens, right?
Right.
Because normally, after down, you're using the sweet spot of the lens, which is always better.
Right.
Almost always. So you assume a very high-quality lens.
Yes. But I should also clarify that you're only capturing the light field that's incident on the sensor. We're not capturing the light field that's incident on the lens. So if your lens is crappy, that's just a different light field. I don't really care. I'm only capturing the light field that's incident on the sensor. So this may be actually another way to compute the distortions in a lens. Because you can put a scene for which you know what the 4D light field should be, and then let it pass through your lens and compute a new light field to see what the distortion was. So you can play some games like that as well.
So would it behoove one to do factory calibration for a particular camera and send that along with the camera?
You could. I mean, there could be a library.
Be better off than a blind calibration.
But this is 4D calibration as opposed to a traditional 2D calibration that does only radial distortion and comma, I mean, vignetting and coma and so on. So this is like a 4D calibration of your work, of your lens. And in fact, the concept you're working on right now is that this might also allow you to characterize the global transforms within the camera, so glare and so on. Okay. So let's move on to the last part, and this is going to be really short, about how we can use illumination that's coded. And I'm going to show one specific application, which is motion capture. You're very familiar with traditional optical motion capture systems, which use high-speed infrared cameras. The Wacom cameras can go up to about 500 hertz. They use very bright IR lights. And your performer or your patient will wear these retroreflective markers, typically on a high contrast background, and so on. And in some cases, instead of retroreflective markers, you may have blinking LEDs. But the system remains about the same. You have high-speed cameras, and either blinking LEDs and retroreflective markers. This is very constraining. What I would like to do is just capture motion of a human body in an environment where it doesn't appear as if the human character is wearing any tags at all. And it could be any ambient light. Okay, that's exactly what we did. Instead of using retroreflective markers or blinking LEDs, the marker I'm using is a photosensing tag. And it's actually a TSOP, which is the same photosensor you have in the remote control, the photosensor that controls the remote control, photosensor that communicates with the remote control of your TV. Okay, so it's receiving light at about 455 kilohertz, so it works in ambient light. And instead of using high-speed cameras, I'm going to use high-speed projectors. And you're all familiar with 3D structured light, 3D extraction using structured light gray codes, where every point in the scene receives a unique code over time. You know, usually you have 10 patterns to scan for 1024 columns, and another 10 patterns to scan in the vertical dimension. But and I'm going to put these photosensing tags to recover their own location. So this is like indoor GPS. Except if I use a traditional projector, it's only at 60 hertz. So at best, I will get about 3 readings because I need 10 and 10, about 20, to get one update. So I might get up to about 3 updates per second. On top of that, a video projector will not work in ambient light. It's too dim. So what we do instead is we have our own very simple and cheap projector. And I have brought the projector here. Something I can just print in the lab on a 3D printer. And what it has is a set of LEDs, 10 particular LEDs, and each LED illuminates a particular code of this bit pattern. So this is just the gray-coded patterns that you would use in 3D scanning. But every LED illuminates only one of them. And because I can switch on and off each of the LED as fast as I want, I can switch them, turn on and off at 60 hertz like a traditional video projector, but I can do them at 1,000 hertz, 10,000 hertz, megahertz, gigahertz. It doesn't really matter. A traditional optical communication system works at a gigahertz. So I know I can turn on and off an LED at, you know, a billion times a second. So I can easily create a structured light projector that can go as fast as a gigahertz. Right? And now the question is, can I use a photosensor that can decode this signal? And of course, that's how optical communication works. There's a photosensor at the other end that's decoding this megahertz or gigahertz signal. And now suddenly I have an optical motion capture system that can work at any speed I want. And because the photosensors can be just a few microns wide, a pixel of a camera is less than 10 microns by 10 microns, I can use a photosensor that's extremely tiny. I can hide it under my clothes. So so it's imperceptible. And because I'm doing this modulation at 455 kilohertz with invisible IR, it's not visible to human eye, and it can work in ambient light. So by turning the problem around of optical motion capture, which is instead of using high-speed cameras, I'm using high-speed projectors, and they're just running in open loop, so there's no bandwidth issue. They're just continuously running. And the photosensors in the space are decoding their own location, just like indoor GPS. So with this system, I can create a motion capture. The tags are postage stamp sized, and this particular, they're poking out from this jacket. And I'm driving the car, and my friend is holding this set of projectors, just handheld, and we're just going to motion capture him in ambient light. This is in Cambridge near the Green Line. And right now we're tracking at 500 hertz because our projectors are running at 10,000 hertz.
So wait, all the sensors are recording their location?
They're individually recording their location, and in this particular case, they're sending it to a base station, and we download the data later. But they can also transmit in a wireless fashion. So the particular tag looks something like this. If it's, and you can do it in daylight, night time. You know, we just asked him to come out of a grocery, a gas station. It's completely robust to that. And this is our kind of prototype board, which has a Bluetooth in the back and the TSOP in the front.
Wait, at what point did your friend who was holding the projector and the camera, at what point did that get calibrated? I mean,
So you just pre-calibrated. In terms of geometry, there's no difference. In terms of the geometric benefits are identical for a camera-based system or a projector-based system. An emitter like this is basically a 1024 pixel camera, effectively.
But the camera that was taking this movie was attached to this.
Exactly. There was just a point gray camera attached at the bottom of this.
So these were okay.
Rigidly attached.
Held by two different people who were actually attached together.
Right. Okay. But the camera could be somewhere else as well.
Yeah.
In this particular case, we made it simple and put it exactly near the...
These two of these are the right angles?
Yes. Okay. And you can put them anywhere you want. You're only getting one coordinate per array. So to get two, you need two, and to get three, you need three, and so on.
And so how far can they see that signal?
So in room light, we can work up to about 5 meters. After 4 meters, it starts getting noisy. But between 2 meters to 5 meters, basically. And in outdoor, it works only about 3 meters right now.
So the same range as a
TV remote control.
Or a little less, or?
Sorry?
Same or less, or is it exactly the same?
It's the operations are the same as a TV remote control. So if your TV can control your TV remote can control your TV, this system will work in that condition because the same piece, same hardware.
How could you improve the range?
You could improve the range by using more power on your LED, or maybe a cluster of LEDs, or using a larger projector, or adding more gain on your sensors. I mean, the optical communication field is a very rich field, and we haven't even tapped into all the optimizations they're doing. Because, you know, by the way, a fact that's rarely, it's not very well known, is that optical bandwidth is increasing by a factor of 10 every 3 years. It's much faster than the Moore's law. The total optical bandwidth is increasing by a factor of 10 every 3 years.
So right now you're capturing relative position.
Yes.
So you want to make it global.
Right.
Then you have to actually compute.
Yeah, it's the same problem as any YCON system. I mean, if you want to do this in an indoor setting, you'll put many of these projectors surround the person because you'll have occlusion effects. It's the same issues. There's no benefit or limitation in terms of the geometry with respect to a camera-based system. But another benefit of that, of course, is that I can print this whole thing for just $10 or $20. It's dirt cheap. So I don't need to buy a $5,000 or $10,000 500 hertz camera, which I cannot use for anything else except for motion capture. Time of flight, how would you do that? That's challenging because we are using optical means here. You could add a gyro to improve accuracy and deal with missing data when there's occlusion. But light travels a foot a nanosecond, so it's difficult to do time of flight with this particular setup. There are new sensors that can record time to picoseconds, time of flight to picoseconds. So maybe that's another way to think about this. But this is just off the shelf. Same components that are in your $5 remote control. Okay. So that's coded illumination. Right now we can do 500 hertz tracking. We get ID per marker. It works in natural environments so that the tags are visually imperceptible under clothes. And ambient lighting is okay. You don't have to be in high contrast controlled environments. And probably the most interesting part is you can use unlimited number of tags. Because it's just like indoor GPS. You can have as many receivers as you like. The space has been labeled. And we can, as I said, we can build the whole thing for just a few tens of dollars. So now we can start thinking about doing motion capture in very casual settings. Maybe for, you know, maybe the next Xbox version of Sony iToy could have very simple motion capture that, you know, a ring or something you wear, or it's a shirt, it has jackets, and you can start playing in front of your TV just by putting this $5 projector that's emitting, it's labeling the space, and you can dance in front of it, for example. Or you can use it for taking care of the elderly people so that they can, you can figure out what activities they're performing without invading their privacy, because there's no camera here. You're just tracking their geometry. And it can be part of their clothing as well. They don't have to wear any complex tags. Or if you want to guide somebody who doesn't have a very good balance down the stairs, and again in an indoor setting, then you can use galvanic vestibular system that can change their sense of balance by giving, you know, just millivolt shocks to their vestibular system. But you also need to have a very good idea of where their body is. So by looking at all the great work that has gone on in motion capture and analysis of dynamics based on motion capture, a lot of work done here as well, you can use that in real time to shock the person so that they can walk down the stairs without losing the balance. Yes?
One is, do these little receivers, the little tags that you wear,
yeah,
they have the wireless built-in, or they have a wire that goes to some other?
You can do it in multiple ways. There are three ways you can do it. One is you can have a wireless module, like what I'm using right now here, just a Bluetooth module. Second is you can store it locally on a memory and then download later. Or third, like you mentioned, you can put it on a base station that's kind of the whole body is collecting at a local unit, and then it can do some runtime compression and send it over the wireless channels.
The other question is improving the resolution. So is there some optical problem with, you know, how many bits, the angular resolution? Like, it would be easy to go from 10 to 20 bits, right?
But yes.
Is that practical?
It's not practical, because you're going to, it's the same thing as building a camera. You can't build a very high resolution camera unless you make corresponding gains in optics, because you are diffraction limited, you're limited by the signal to noise ratio of your pixels and so on. So you have all the traditional limitations you would have of increasing the resolution of a camera over here. But the point is, they're so cheap, you can just flood them. Instead of putting them every 1 meter, you can put them every 50 centimeters and use that to improve the accuracy. And what we have shown so far is that we can record at the precision of 100 micrometers at the distance of 1 meter. So that's what we have been able to prove in the paper that's coming up at SIGGRAPH this year. And we also have this as a part of emerging technologies, where what we'll show is that, as far as we know, this is the very first motion capture system that's also lighting aware. So the woman here is wearing the jacket with all the tags, but it also senses the incident light, because it's a photosensor. So if her prop here, which is just a stick, has to be replaced with a sword, it will also change, the synthetic sword will also change its color. It will be blue where the background light is blue, and it will be red where the background light is red. So the synthetic elements can be added in real time and sensitive to incident light.
These sensors sense the spectrum.
So I'm cheating a little bit. So I'm going to use the traditional TSOP that the TV uses. Okay. But instead of using sensing the spectrum on the same sensor, I added one more RGB sensor that's sensing the spectrum. But you can imagine in the future, both can be in a single package. One 10 by 10 micrometer will sense the IR, and the neighboring 10 by 10 micrometers will sense, or maybe three 10 by 10 micrometers will sense the RGB. But the whole thing will be still less than 0.1 millimeter. And that's the benefit of a a photosensor versus an LED. An LED has to capture some, has some area to emit light, and it has to have battery and so on. But a photosensor can be just a few microns and doesn't require much power because it's completely passive. Okay. Just to finish off then, another reason to observe people is to interpret their gestures. And a common problem in a scene like this, if you start with some edge representation, you get confused with the texture edges and edges that you may not really care about. But wouldn't it be great if we can just get the shape contours, the depth edges? And that's exactly what we did using a camera, which we call a multi-flash camera, and we presented this at SIGGRAPH 2004. So here we are really coding the position of the light sources. We know that if the flash is to the left of a camera, then you see this annoying sliver of shadow to the right of each depth discontinuity. But if you intentionally put the flash on the other side, then each of the shadow moves to the left of each depth discontinuity. And if you put the flash on the top, the shadows are at the bottom. And if the flash at the bottom, the shadows on the top, and so on. And by analyzing the shadows, we can compute the depth discontinuities, which some like to call occluding contours or shape contours or silhouettes. And compared with intensity edges, these edges really capture the meaningful information, meaningful shape information in the scene. And this SIGGRAPH paper we presented, we simply superimposed a brightened version of this original image to create the cartoon. So to conclude, coded imaging, sometimes less is more. By blocking light in time, we can reversibly encode the motion blur and support in software very high quality motion deblurring. By blocking light in space, we can perform multiple things. I explained the concept of optical heterodyning and analyzed the light field in the frequency domain and looked at two special cases. The first special case is putting the mask in the aperture that performs convolution in the primal domain. And from that, we can support focus deblurring. If you put the mask close to the sensor, then it turns out by using a very narrow band mask, we can capture the light field at a reduced resolution. On the other hand, by putting masks in front of LEDs, I demonstrated that you can create a spatio-temporally encoded space in which photosensors can recover their location, and that can be supported for motion capture. And also showed how you can code, strategically place the light sources so that you can compute the shape contours. So these are examples where, instead of thinking about epsilon photography, where we are perturbing the camera parameters and taking multiple pictures, we might be able to take just one or just a few pictures and encode a very rich representation of the scene on a 2D sensor so that we can support very sophisticated post-processing operations. Thank you.